Okay, well, welcome again, everybody, to Make Stories Sparkle with the Storytime Show, a dynamic, successful model of literacy in action. We are honored with Gwen's presence this morning, all the way from the UK. So I'm going to hand it over to Gwen, and she can sparkle along for us. Thank you so much, Gwen.
Thank you. Hello, everybody, and a warm welcome to this webinar. The title of our webinar is Make Stories Sparkle with the Storytime Show. My name is Gwyn McCormack, and I am the Director of Positive Eye here in the United Kingdom. And I'd like to welcome my wonderful colleagues to introduce themselves. Donna, would you like to go?
Hi, everyone. Good morning. It's the morning here. And I'm Donna Carpenter, and I am so happy and so lucky to be the coordinator, the state coordinator for our Kentucky Deafblind Project, and work with just fabulous people all over the place. I'm going to throw it over to my friend over here, Megan.
Hello, everyone. I'm Megan Burgess. I am a deafblind specialist. I have a background in American Sign Language and Deaf culture and therapeutic recreation. This is Little Hattie, Marvin's number one fan. We are so excited to be here today. Back to you, Gwyn.
Thank you. During our presentation, we're going to look at the essential literacy access skills that underpin the Storytime Show. And we're going to look at how the components of the Storytime Show have supported literacy outcomes for children with complex learning needs so successfully. But are you ready for the beginning of the Storytime Show? I think it's time for me to put on my sparkly hat, my drastic Drake dragonfly sparkly hat. And it's time to welcome you to the greatest Storytime Show ever. It's the Sparkly Box of Stories Storytime Show. Whoop-a-dee-doo. Storytime Show together. The little girl is so excited. She watches the laptop on the right of the screen with her mum. All the crafts from the show are on the stool next to her. A family watching the Storytime Show. So very exciting. The little girl traces around the characters. She loves Super Sparkle, who's in the screen. And she can see Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn just there in the screen with Super Sparkle. From top to toe, every muscle is tense. This little girl is called Asha. She's from Tennessee. She vocalizes and shouts at the storyteller. She yells at me all the way through the Storytime Show. Can you imagine that for the little girl and the joy that brings for the whole family to see their daughter enjoying literacy at home in such a wonderful way? It's so, so very exciting. Her mum says to me, "This is the highlight of this little girl's week. Asha just loves the Storytime Show." Asha is one of many children who, for the last 20 months, have participated in a virtual Storytime Show, inclusively of the whole family. How incredible for the family to be able to watch something inclusively together. So exciting. So what is the concept behind the Storytime Show? The aim of the Storytime Show is to encourage, build confidence and participation in stories at home by the whole family, inclusively of their child with complex learning needs. It would be presented virtually to increase the opportunity for participation by all families anywhere. I wanted a story time that the whole family could enjoy together. I keep saying that, don't I? The whole family. The whole family. I had this idea, it still is in my heart, about the whole family doing something together around story. I wanted parents to find their inner child again. Do you know where your inner child is? Have you found your inner child again as an adult? I found mine in my 60s, in my late 50s and 60s. I am so, so glad that I have done, because I think it's something that can leave us very easily. And we forget about being a child ourselves. We're so busy being adults, aren't we? It's so great. I have so much fun now. I've found my inner child again. So I wanted parents to find their inner child, that joyous feeling, that innocence, that love of just having fun, that innocent fun. And know where the starting point was for stories with their child. Finding the starting point, sometimes we don't start because we don't know where the starting point is, do we? And we can't actually visualize the starting point or imagine what we will look like at that starting point, so we don't. I've done it lots of times in my life. But when you find the starting point, it's a whoopity-doo moment. I wanted parents to gain confidence in creating their own story time shows at home, just having fun around the kitchen, having fun at home, you know, just having plain old, good, old-fashioned fun to tell the story, to do funny voices. I've got two funny voices, that's all, as well as my own. To sing the songs, to use the rhymes and the funny little dances that I made up. I called it a show because it's so much more exciting, isn't it? A show for children with complex learning needs, a group of children that are always overlooked when it comes to shows on TV. I really wanted them to have a show that's special for them that they could get really excited about. Oh, it's Thursday, it's Gwyn, it's Storytime Show. I wanted the family to feel excited and be counting down the hours to the Storytime Show. So what was important to consider in developing this concept? Wow, what a concept for me to be developing. Here we go, let's think about that now. So as we know, literacy begins in the everyday experience of the child. I really, truly believe it's right around us right now, all day, every day. And sometimes we miss the greatest opportunities because we're looking for something in a gold box. It's not in a gold box. It's in the kitchen, the bathroom, the garden. It's in everything we do. And we know that the children we work with miss out on those really important incidental learning opportunities. I wanted, therefore, something to guide my work. And I love the research by Alan Koenig and Carol Farrenkopf, Essential Experiences to Undergird the Early Development of Literacy for Children with Vision Impairment or Vision Loss. They identified 22 essential early life experiences to which young children with vision impairment or vision loss need to be exposed to undergird their development of literacy. I love, love, love this research. I talk about it all the time. It guides my work. I give it out at courses. I've made a template with it on. I think it should sit above the head of every single child we ever work with, because we need to look at these 22 experiences ahead of the story and think, right, these are the concepts we're going to be covering in the story after Easter. So now, a month before my Easter holiday, I need to be looking at the concepts that are going to be in that story and looking at what I need to work on with the child so that they're ready to participate in the story when we go back after Easter. And I'm not trying to teach those concepts at the same time as deliver the story. So I need to cue them to the characters, to the objects, to the concepts well in advance. So if I use these 22 experiences, it helps me look at my story and what experiences they're covering. Every single teacher everywhere should be using this research. And I put no age attached to that. It's an ageless piece of research. I love it. I'm so glad that Daniel Downs here in the UK introduced it to me. So there isn't time to show you the 22, but I'm just going to read four. They make complete sense to me, and I'm sure they will to you. Doing or making things. Massive part of literacy, model making, craft making. Experiences with friends. Marvin has lots of those. Working together, sharing and helping, looking for or finding something. So they went across those 257 reading books and extracted the 22 common themes that kept cropping up. Brilliant research. Thank you, Alan, and thank you, Carol. You have guided my work beyond belief with that research, and I share that all the time. I'm forever grateful to them for that. So my 22 essential experiences undergird every single story I've written. And yes, I've got wacky characters, because stories have wacky characters for children, don't they? But it's pinned into everyday experience. And I can find a million learning ideas from every story that I do, because they start in the everyday experience of the child. And it's so much fun. So what are the important elements in developing that concept? What other elements do we need to think about? I always like to think about those literacy access skills. That's what I call them. Please, I know everybody has a different name for these. It's just what I call them. And these, in my head, these are the specific skills we're going to teach a child with complex learning needs, CVI, vision impairment, whatever the child's needs are. We're going to teach them some literacy access skills that is going to be a special package that is individual to that child. So the literacy access skills, think of them like aeroplanes, and they in our country we have the Red Arrow team, which is our display team, and they zoom through the sky and they let off a different rainbow smoke funnel behind them. And that's what I am reminded of with these literacy access skills. So, and there are more than I've got time to tell you, but these are the key ones. Concept development at the heart and integral to everything I'm going to say now. Concept development, fine motor skills, tactile discrimination skills, auditory and language development, visual skills, attention, fixation, tracking, scanning, book and story skills. Yeah, zooming through the sky. So there's a lot happening above the child's head, isn't there? Because there's the 22 essential experiences. Then we've got those literacy access skills, and we pull down the ones we need and we create the package for the child. And that package might change as we teach those skills. They are there learning to access skills. They are the skills they need to enable them to access stories, literacy, numeracy, the world around them. So important. Every single teacher everywhere in the world needs to have those arrows above every child's head, and in their planning well ahead of story time, that's what needs to be thought of, not on the day that the story is beginning to be told to the rest of the class. And also, we need to teach this and share this with parents. It's the same thing. I train parents, I do courses for parents and professionals, and I say the same to both. I don't have a different course, it's all the same, because we all need to do this together. It's exciting. I love story time. I love talking about literacy in this way. It makes it doable and possible by everybody, all of us. It makes it easy and doable by thinking of these ways. It's easy. So let's think of some more things I had to think about in realizing the concept of the Storytime Show. How exciting! What was going on in my mind as I developed this idea? I needed a character. Oh, I wonder who that's going to be. Tricky to think, really, isn't it? It's me, Gwyn. Oh, come on, Gwyn. I waited for this moment all my life. No way. Hello, Marvin. Oh, hello, Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn. How are you today? Well, I'm so well, Marvin. It's fantastic to see you. Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn, always lovely to see you. I love you, Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn. And I love you, Marvin. Oh, Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn. 34 people? Wow! I know, it's exciting, isn't it, Marvin? Where are they from, Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn? Well, there's some people from America. America? Yeah. And United Kingdom. Ah, and United Kingdom. Ah, Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn. It's great, isn't it? Are you excited, Marvin? Oh, too right I am. So am I, Marvin. Oh, it's great to see you all. I'm the main man. Everybody, I wear a yellow jumper, I've got black spiky hair, black framed glasses and green shorts, and I'm Gwyn's friend. And the main thing about me you need to know is I'm really kind and helpful, and I love everybody, and I love meeting new people and making new friends. And me and Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn have been everywhere. We have, Marvin, haven't we? So I created the character of Marvin, and I wrote my first two adventures. And then I stopped because I needed to map those stories to those 22 essential experiences. Do you know what? The first one I wrote was Marvin's Market Adventure. Apart from one, which I probably could have shoehorned in, I linked it to 21 of those experiences. I was, wow, that's amazing that I've managed to do that. So, and that what that meant was that I knew I was covering all those experiences as I was delivering the story. So I knew I was really underpinning their early development of literacy. But it also meant I could look at the child and what experiences they had and what experiences they were missing out on, their gaps in their incidental learning, and I could fill the gaps and concentrate on those concepts. And yes, I may not have known precisely what those concepts are that they're missing, but if I've worked with a child, I'll have a fairly good idea of perhaps my starting point. And of course, you know, we can always refill and go back. If we're not sure, we can reinforce. So I've got my character, I've written my stories, I've linked it to the essential experiences and the literacy access skills as well at the same time. Now then, I need somewhere to do this, don't I? Where am I going to perform it when I'm doing it virtually? Well, I live in a really tiny house and I don't have the luxury of big TV studios. So I have been creative and thrifty and I made my own studio right here where I am today. And this is the picture of my studio. And it's where I'm working today, but it's taken from a different angle. So you can see on the left, I've got black felt up to give a matte finish and high contrast. I've got my characters, I've got the Marvins out there, so various Marvins, and I've created just in the smallest of spaces, this TV studio, and I have a table to my left. And you can just see the camera lights in the distance on the top right. I have huge camera lights on my desk. So they're probably the fancy bits. And I just work off one Alki webinar camera. And that's all it is. It's really makeshift. You know, it's nothing special. The only reason I'm wearing blue rather than black is because the lighting, because I'm only on one webcam. If I wear all black, the lighting affects my face and the way I look. And you can't see what I'm showing you. Otherwise, if I was with a child face to face, I would be wearing black. It's just I struggle with the light, and that's why there's one or two more characters up this afternoon to balance the light. That's the only technical difficulty that I often experience when I'm delivering online. So that's the reason for the blue rather than the black. Okay, so talking about what to wear, I normally, because although black is good, and I know we promote black and I promote wearing black all the time, it depends what you're doing. And sometimes on screen, I think, well, I want the child to look at me. I want them to engage with me. I want them to look towards me. So I often go for the high contrast outfit, and I tend to put a scarf in my neck just to tidy my neck up, really, and just try and give it that high contrast outfit. And I wear glittery hats that I make. These are just made with grey board and glittery paper that really, that because it's sunny here this afternoon, and I've got my spotlights on above, it blasts the colour out a little bit. But the glitter paper is brilliant. It's from Amazon. It's a particular make. No other glitter paper will do, apart from the springboard supplies, one that I use. I highly recommend. Under the spotlight, it glitters deeply, and it's just fantastic. And the children love the glitter paper. Do not underestimate any one of these small parts I'm showing you, because each one has had an impact on some child somewhere who's watched the Storytime show. So the outcomes just from the glitter paper are immense. And it's so low cost as well. And everybody can make a glittery hat. You can just do a simple cat, a simple ball, a dog. You know, just something really simple. So, you know, they're an important part of the Storytime event. It also encourages children to look in their upper field of vision. So then I became Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn. What day did that happen? I suddenly woke up and I thought, I'm not Gwyn anymore. I'm Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn. I've got a new name. I really love my new name, actually. A Gwyn 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 Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn. My name is Gwyn 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 Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn. So let's think about the structure of a Storytime show, because you can all go and do this. This is the idea that everybody does Storytime shows and has loads of fun. I always welcome the children. Whoop-a-doo, woo-woo-woo. You can't shake your pom-poms and go woo-woo-woo at the same time. You've got to do it separately. I put my pom-poms onto a wooden spoon. I put maracas and bells in. I made them really big to make sure that they came to the screen to have a look what was going on. So, easy. Cheerleader pom-poms, we can all buy those, can't we? They're simple to get hold of. Engage attention. It's all about engaging attention. Engage, engage, engage. I've got to be really engaging. There's no point me being timid. I'm not going to get very far if I'm timid. Gwyn, 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 my name is Gwyn, 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 Donna, Donna, hello, Donna, Megan, Megan, hello, Megan, Sarah, whoop, Sarah, whoop. So every child receives an individual name call over and over again. I say their name. I give them a welcome. It's wonderful to see you. Thanks for joining us. We love having you along. It's wonderful to see you. You're wonderful. You're incredible. Try and make every child feel really special. £2.49, 6 centimetre yellow pom-poms, glued on with hot glue gun. Everybody can make those. Great for hello and goodbye in their day-to-day life. Highly recommend for visual attention and fixation. If everybody wore those gloves during the day, every time they waved hello or goodbye to a child, imagine that, the impact during the day on literacy. Literacy in action would be incredible. It's easy. Everybody can put on a pair of those gloves, can't they? For £2.49. Social interaction, ongoing interaction and connection. We wave, don't we? Yeah, we wave, Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn. Hello, everybody. My name's Marvin. A one and a two and a wonderful three. And we do a big wave, and all the boys and girls have got their Marvin dolls. In America, they all have their various Marvin dolls, and they have them with them, and we wave to each other. And we always say thank you for the Storytime show. We do, Gwynny Gwyn Gwyn. Oh, we always give Marvin a hug too. Storytelling. There is a story of Marvin's adventure. Now, some of the children understand the words and some of them don't. But the point of this is, this Storytime show, there's something for everybody. It might not all be for everybody, but you take your component parts and it works. Every bit, there's a little bit of something for everybody. And sometimes it's just the rhythm of my voice that they're listening to. And sometimes, because they've connected with the story and listening to the sound, they will then focus on another story time better than they used to. So don't get bogged down by the fact that, well, they'll never understand those words, Gwyn. Yeah, I know that already. And I just do the story because I've got 18-year-olds and 3-year-olds watching this and every learning need possible. So it's inclusive and it's adaptable to the family and to that child. So the glittery characters. Now, Martin and I, my husband, I have to include Martin because without Martin, I don't know, we've done 24/7 months at a time in the early days creating. They're wonderful characters. They're made on grey board. We use glitter paper and acrylic paint. Let's, are you ready? 1, 2, 3. Here we go, everybody. 1, 2, 3. Let's ribbit, ribbit, 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 let's ribbit, ribbit. Boom, 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 with a go, 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 T, go with a boom. Let's go. With a boom, 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 boom. Are you ready? Are you steady? So we just do simple rhymes the children love. Fabulously fabulous, Fabiano the Frog. He's written into every adventure as a result. He wears a pink hat, green face, and he has a pink sparkly bag. And he is one of the children's favourites. But he does have competition with Princess Peggy, Princess Peggy, we love Princess Peggy. A Princess Peggy, Princess Peggy, we love Princess Peggy. She has pink curly hair, black sparkly glasses, and a pink dress with an ice cream on. So lots and lots. I think I have just under 100 characters. This is one of the bees from the new farm adventure. So, and as you can see behind me, I've got more there. So very simple, glittery characters. And I bring those to the screen. And as you saw earlier, the little girl, Asha, traces around them. Brilliant for visual attention. Brilliant for understanding shape. Amazing. And then we have songs. Our son Tom, Maestro Tomati Tom, has written so many beautiful songs. I wish I had time to show them all to you because they're so beautiful and they enrich the Storytime show so wonderfully. And all the families receive copies of the songs, Tom singing them, and they get the words so they can sing them around the house, in the car, in the shower, when they're playing. I know lots of families have incorporated these approaches within the play of the child at other times during the week. They're using these songs, they're using the strategies I've shown you so far in play and around the house. Asha certainly is one little girl where that's happening. So I'm really proud to share the new song from the new show. It's like a musical, isn't it? It's like going to the theatre, and that's what I want it to be like for the children. So you see Drastic Drake, the dragonfly. I'm Drastic Drake, the dragonfly. I'm Bustling Beanie the Bee. I'm Drastic Drake, the dragonfly. I'm Bustling Beanie the Bee. They're my favourite characters from the new farm adventure I'm doing in a few weeks. So I'm going to share the song that Tom's written. So let's just find it. Here it is. Let me share the sound. Go, Tomati Tom.
Drake might be called Drastic, but he's really quite fantastic. May I give you some clues as to why? Well, he's tiny, very shiny. Not the least bit is he slimy, and best of all, those wings can really fly. He runs the blustery bloom patch crew with Beanie the Bee too, and they're here to save the day for me and you. So buckle up and buckle in, let the fun and games begin. With Drake, Beanie and Marvin, we can't not win.
So I sing those songs on the show. Now I am not a singer, I'm not trying to be a singer. I'm not trying to be an actor. This is not what this is about. It's not a polished performance. You don't have to do polished performances. It's just about singing. I never thought I could sing. I never thought I could run until a few weeks ago. I want everybody to just go for it and let go, let rip around the house. Because I think children just love that. You know, they laugh, they think it's funny, don't they? And then you laugh about it. And laughing is so good for our well-being, isn't it? So, you know, truly and deeply sing from the bottom of your beautiful hearts. And actually we have a song that Tom's written for parents, called that. I just don't have time to show it to you today. But if you follow me on Facebook, I often share the songs on there because I want everybody to have them and just know about them really, because they're so beautiful. And I know he's my son, but I say that without him being my son. They're just perfect. They're the ethos of this show and they bring great richness. So how would the Storytime show reach the families? In March 2020, a pandemic arrived, taking us online. Families were very isolated, long days and limited access to services. It was time to respond and take the Storytime show concept online. It's like their own TV show. Can you imagine that for the children? How wonderful to have their own TV show to watch. And the parents, I think, would be watching the clock. Come on, Grinny Gwyn Gwyn, hurry along. It's nearly 4 o'clock. We can have a cup of tea and a piece of cake while my child watches the show on their own. Imagine that for the family. It was time for a show that engaged an overlooked group of children when it comes to a fun online Storytime show. I really passionately believe that this group of children, children with complex learning needs, are overlooked by the TV companies. So we made our own. Yeah, hooray. A mum recently said to me, I love having them because it is hard to find online stories on the internet that she will pay attention to. Imagine the mum saying that. It's hard for her to find anything that her daughter will watch, you know? And that's really soul destroying for the mum, isn't it? You know, she's trying to find something that's not, that there's nothing suitable. So I've now got two beautiful children. These are my biggest long-time showgoers, and some of you know who they are. And first of all, it's the amazing Oliver, I used to say. And he was one of the first showgoers. To be honest, I could just stop the recording now and say no more, because that face tells you everything. And that's, I could just stop now. Beautiful. The little boy, Oliver, smiles and engages with me. He watches on his laptop. He would blow kisses to me. He'd be fully engaged for the whole show. I mean, that photograph brings me the greatest joy. So his mum, lovely mum, Leah, I know Leah, and would find that, I know she would be overjoyed with that picture as she shared it with me. Just an amazing photograph. It just makes me laugh and smile so happily. And then Zachariah. And he loved the way I did that. I'd go for a low voice and he'd be hollering at me and lifting his arms and blowing kisses. And so he's there sitting right in front of the screen. Rochelle has put a big screen up in her room to make sure he's got the best access possible. And this was in the early days when I wasn't as refined as I am now. How exciting. So I did that for 4 months for hundreds of families across the world, 3 times a week on Facebook. And Martin and I worked like crazy people to keep up with ourselves. And then it was time to talk to my wonderful, amazing, incredible colleague, Dr. Donna Carpenter. And I said to Donna, hey, Donna, how about a Storytime show for your children? And Donna being Donna went, of course, Gwyn, let's do a Storytime show. And this was about the September 2020. And this is a picture of Donna holding Marvin, myself, we're ready to go on the show, and Brian, one of our amazing interpreters. And I spoke to Donna and we set off with our story time show. And actually it became a huge, it is now an ongoing, a huge collaboration across 22 states in America, from Alaska down to the British Virgin Islands. We've reached hundreds and hundreds of families. We've got already 83 signed up for Farm Adventure and we're 2 weeks away from registration deadline. That shows you the popularity of the show. So they've worked together. The Deafblind projects in America are incredible and they work so beautifully together. They collaborate, they cost share, they come together to make it work for each other and for the families they support. They are truly special and I feel so blessed and honoured to work with them. I really do, from the bottom of my heart, I do. Just amazing, an amazing group of professionals. It's my honour to work with them. So Donna is amazing and she just got the ball rolling. And then Megan, who you met earlier, heard about it in the Midwest. She got wind on the pipeline and said to Donna, I really want that story time show. And Donna being Donna shared everything. And then the Midwest started and that's how it's reached 22 states so far. But I think it's time to watch a story time show clip. There is music behind this clip, just because it's sort of more like the little promotional clip, but on the show, there isn't the music going on behind. But I just use this to lift it when I'm just showing short clips. So the clip I'm going to show you is the beginning of the zoo adventure. It's only short, and this is Donna introducing me. I love watching back our story time show clips. So just bear with me 1 second, because we have to get techie with the technology now, and everybody cross your fingers that everything's going to work for me now. I've brought it all up ready. So with a bit of luck, yeah, here we go. I'm just going to drop that down so it's not in the way. I'm going to make that big and I'm going to press go. Bear with me, technology.
Hi everyone.
Got it now. Stay calm with technology. So that's just a short clip, just a few parts of it clipped together. There is a story within there. And I do beg your pardon because I forgot to show you my rainbow wheel. I use that to engage at the beginning of the story time show. It's the best £1 I've ever spent. Okay, so how has the Storytime Show model promoted story time at home? What do let's start to think about what the parents think. They say they've seen increased communication, increased engagement, better vocalization, better participation in other story time shows. So there's a picture here of James. His mum set up a black background. She's printed up the images. You can see the crafts around the laptop. You can see him watching me on the screen with the frog, the ribbit frog next to him, and Marvin on the right hand side. So she set up a little TV studio for him to watch at home. And then this is Miranda, who's in her teens, and she loved the Storytime Show. And she engages like that, holds that position throughout the whole Storytime Show, is fully engaged. And interestingly, her class team had said to Mum that Miranda couldn't participate in Storytime at school and they didn't know what to do. And her mum said, yes, she can, and this is what you need to do. And they took the recordings and used those to help the teachers to understand how to engage with Miranda, because Miranda can take part. It's just you've got to use the right approaches to engage her attention. But that's those outcomes that I've just reeled off are huge, aren't they? Engagement, communication, participation, vocalization, attention. Incredible. So let's really delve in now to the parents and what the parents say. My child is taking part in stories with greater concentration. She is now asking questions and is engaged. The teacher said to Mum, I don't understand the change. And Mum answered, why? She's watching Miss Gwynny Gwyn's Storytime Show. And another mum said, Storytime has helped her to start paying more attention to stories being read in class. She shows so much more interest in stories than she did before we started Storytime with you. I mean, wow, that is amazing, isn't it? What is it that's making that happen? She's paying more attention in other story times, never mind the story time she's doing with me online. So very exciting. And another mum, my daughter engages in a new and different way. Her attention and focus is improving and she is more vocal. Incredible. And then I want to introduce you to Jade. This is Jade, who's three. She's sitting in a chair, she's got a smile on her face, she's holding Marvin, and she's got beautiful Betty Bird to the right, which is her craft. We make a craft on the Storytime Show each time, and all the children receive a craft bag with the right materials in, ready to go. This is where it's a big production, and the Deafblind projects are amazing in facilitating this. Jade loved this week's craft and show. Miss Gwen is so enthusiastic that our sweet girl lifted her head to watch. This takes a lot of work for her, so we know she must have enjoyed it. We can't wait for next week. That comment is beautiful. Her mum said to me, all we ever want is for Jade to lift her head. That's all we ask in life, that she can lift her head. So imagine that as an outcome from the Storytime Show. So I'm going to show you Jade, and this was in the first week that she watched the show. But just bear with me again while we dive into the world of technology and hope that it doesn't go round and round and not play nice with me. Let's see how we get on with that. Get rid of that, get rid of that, get rid of that. Okay, we're coming back. Here we go. It's always stressful with technology. Right, here we are, folks.
Hello, boys and girls. It's Midwest Marvin. Hello. Hello, hello, hello. Can you all wave? Hello. Hello, hello. Hello, hello, hello. Give him a big wave, boys and girls. Wave to Midwest Marvin. Whoop-a-dee-doo.
That's incredible, isn't it? To see how she lifted her head and it went down, back up, down. She was really wanting to know what was going on in the screen. So now I want to show you 3 weeks later. And this is what Mum said 3 weeks later. This is so that Mum said, this girl loves her some Gwyn and Marvin. Every time Gwyn comes on, she looks right at the screen. I mean, that's incredible. She looks right at the screen because there's something going on she wants to see. What a blessing to have something that Jade reacts to on her own. Big moves for this strong little girl. It stands out to me that the on her own, incredible that the family can then watch the story time show. The little girl, sorry, can watch the story time show on her own. And that's, for me, beautiful, a beautiful outcome from the show. Okay, I'm going to show you Jade 3 weeks later. Just one second while I bring that up for you. So far, so good. Technology is playing nicely. Here we go. To be honest, that's another, I just don't need to say any more. Jade tells the story for us, doesn't she? There's no more to be said because Jade says it so beautifully. I could watch that video over and over again. And her mum says she watches the whole show like that for the whole hour, by the way. She's three and couldn't lift her head 3 weeks ago. It's happening now from the Storytime show. Incredible. It makes me the happiest woman on this earth to see Jade doing that in that way. From simple techniques that everybody can do. Not just me, everybody can do this. Incredible. And I love the way she holds Marvin and never lets him go. It's so adorable. I love it so much. Right, moving on. I'm going to skip forward a couple because we're just watching my time. So I want to show you Jackson. Jackson, he's a great little boy. This is a really beautiful photograph of Jackson. Just bear with me and I'll just get that ready for you. And this is how Jackson watches the show. It's so cute. He's so beautiful. He watches the show with his chin on the laptop. And his mum says he watches like that for the whole hour. Doesn't move a muscle. She said, thank you for creating this beautiful story time for our children. And she says he hasn't let go of his Marvin doll and he's been engaged in pretend play, clapping hands and trying to make him dance and walk. It's been amazing to watch, especially as this was one of our long-term goals. Your story time adds so much to our home education. It engages him. He claps and smiles, laughs. He's glued to the screen. He doesn't react that way to any other show or session that we attend on Zoom. Amazing. An amazing outcome for that little boy. I'll just show you a couple of a tiny bit of this, because this is one day after the show. He went and got his Marvin doll. And this is what his mum, one of the things she was referring to, that he got his doll. And she said for 2 hours, he sat in the window playing with the doll. It'd been a long-term goal for 2 hours, never before, and they couldn't get over it. This is really beautiful. So just hang on while I get that up on my screen ready to show you. Here we are. There's not much talking. This is just one to watch and observe his actions. Oh, it's going to play silly things. Come on. Right, it's working now. Sorry. Here we go. And he did that for the whole afternoon. Imagine that for the parents to see and observe that. And his mum, Donna, shared that with me via Facebook Messenger. I feel so privileged when parents want to just get in touch with me to show that such a beautiful little boy, and what a beautiful outcome from the Storytime show. It melts my heart completely and utterly. Okay, back to our story, back to our PowerPoint presentation. So this is Asha again that I showed you at the beginning. And I'm just cueing us back into Asha. This is Michelle, mom of Asha. Asha truly reacts differently to the show. It grounds her as well. She was having a difficult time due to tooth pain. None of her norms were soothing her. So I asked her, did she want to watch Gwynny Gwyn's Storytime show? Her tears stopped. She became excited. The rainbow spin that visual stimulation delivers every time. So wonderful that the little girl knows what it is that will help her and make her feel happy. I mean, that's wonderful for that, for Asha, isn't it? The start with the story time is part of Asha's physiotherapy, occupational therapy. I place the computer at one end of the room. Asha loves the show so much, she walks the distance unassisted to get to the screen. The photo of her pointing to the screen was during the goodbyes. She was touching everyone's faces and blowing kisses. She shows her absolute focus and concentration during the story. She said, her mum said to me, she just focuses in a completely different way to TV. I mean, that's incredible, isn't it? They just love the Storytime show so much. I'm going to skip down to Liam. Liam is 14 and from Wisconsin, and he's an avid Braille reader and always reads the stories ahead in Braille. And his mum said to me, Liam absolutely loves the Marvin stories, characters and music. She said to me, it's really enriched his life. He signs them. He loves the ribbit, let's ribbit, ribbit, let's ribbit, ribbit. And then this parent, we love the family story time. Not only does it provide literacy, but it also increases fun, playtime, and bond with my family. Yeah, hooray. And this is another parent. My daughter usually does 20 minutes or so at a time, and sometimes we have the noise off. She likes the glitter characters that move around. She doesn't follow the story, but I have all the pictures cut out for her to hold And when you have a new character on screen, I have a match the same one to hold. So this is really great. And the parent carries on to say, she loves to flip paper and rub it on her face, so it makes her part of the story. It's how she likes to experience things, so I try to make it meaningful in whatever way it can be for her. Usually the part with the names we have noise off because it's a bit overwhelming for her to listen and look. But when you say her name, we turn the noise on for her to hear it. I really like that because it's the parent has done what I wanted. They've adapted the story time to suit their child and they've made it work for them. And I know this parent said to me, we're waiting patiently for the April story time show to start. Okay, I just want to show you a very few minutes of an interview with between two parents. I'll only show a tiny bit of this amazing interview between Morgan and Karonika, two parents who watched the Storytime show, and Donna, who is with us today, interviewed the parents along with Tony and Anna, two of the other Deafblind projects from Mississippi and Tennessee. And Morgan and Karonika shared what it was like before story time started and after. So I'll just show you a couple of minutes and then I'm going to bring my colleagues Donna and Megan in to do some to chat as well. So I'm just watching my time very carefully and I'm conscious of that. So let me just find, and if YouTube, I hope YouTube will play nicely now for me. Here we go. All being well. So I'm going to show you a little bit of this and then I'm going to skip along a bit.
I want to ask you to tell us just a little bit about what each of you knew about your child's literacy skills before all the story time started. So Morgan, could I ask you to go first?
Mm-hmm. We were basically starting from scratch with James because he is so young. We knew that he wasn't responding well to what you typically think of literacy, such as books, with his vision issues and the 2D images. So we were working really hard on verbalizing stories, trying to act things out with objects, or even puppet shows, anything that we could do like that. The more we have worked on literacy with him and skills, and the more confident I got specifically through story time, we are starting to interact more with actual books and learning how to turn the pages and touch, you know, if we're reading about a red bird, we touch the red bird. And then I try to back that up with some physical tactile objects as well.
But using some of those non-traditional forms of literacy, it sounds like a lot of what you're doing also.
Yes, to start with, because books were just not appropriate for him. We weren't getting anywhere.
Okay. Karonika, would you like to share about Delilah and what you knew about her literacy?
Yeah. Before we started story time, we had a little knowledge about literacy because we went to the school at USM for early development children. And so they had started working with her some with using like a pod book and two switches to navigate on the computer through stories. And so we had that. And some, she talked some and used some words before story time. Like she may tell us eat or she may call mom and dad. But for this navigating through the stories, she did not. She would not follow along with the stories. She would not pay attention when you read a story to her or ask her any questions. And she may have concepted from the story. She did not.
Okay. Very good.
So Morgan, what was your initial response to story time? So the first time, you know, we had sent out our emails inviting families to come participate in this great story time with Gwyn, and when you first saw it and James experienced it, what were kind of your first thoughts of the story time?
I was not sure what to expect. We were very excited to do this. He was delayed starting preschool because of COVID, and I was just desperate to get some sort of structured literacy component into his day. And with him being so young, I think he might have been the youngest in our initial story time group. I was not sure if he could sit still that long or pay attention for that long. Also, just with all the noises and things, if that would be sensory overwhelming to him, I just did not know what to expect. I was shocked that he could sit there for an entire hour and be actively engaged and participating. We are at a point where he cries when it's over. we have recorded some so we can play them for him when we're not in the middle of a story time class with Miss Gwyn, just because he loves it so much. But even with him being so young, I'm not sure how much of like the character development he understands yet or something like that. And some of the crafts we have to do for him, and we just use those as manipulatives while she's reading the story. But I was shocked that he was able to participate the way that he did.
Oh, and I love that he's communicating by letting you know when he's upset that it's over. That's those tactile cues is fabulous. Veronica, what about your family? What did you guys think the first time you walked into story time and watched it?
Yes, very similar to Maria. We was very excited about it, just didn't know what to expect. And so once we first started the story the first time, and I was like, oh, she wasn't paying attention, and I didn't think that she was concepting or understanding like really what was going on. But I was the one that was wrong. I mean, listening more than I thought, and she was really enjoying it. And as the time went, I just saw how she had growth in story time. And so for us, just the first time, I was concerned about, would she be able to follow along with the story? Would she concept what was actually going on in the story? And like, you know, just know what is happening. And so that was one of my biggest concerns and initial thoughts.
Even just the time Miss Gwyn takes to begin each session and calling out the children's names, that was something big for James that I saw. I didn't know that he had specifically recognized his name before, and watching him have the anticipation of her calling out each kid's name, and then it got to where we could tell that he was definitely recognizing and getting excited when it was his turn.
Great. What a great observation.
Yes, that was a similar experience with us also. Like, she loves to hear her name called. Like, when we say Lila, she just go over the top and just green. And she know, like, oh, this is about me.
Yeah.
It's a very wonderful experience.
I feel really sad to cut that interview short. It was 30 minutes long, and it's just really brilliant to listen to, and I hate cutting it short, I really do, because it's just gold material, and so lovely that those two parents gave up their time to share. And that was presented at a really big conference in America. Donna submitted a proposal, and just joyous, isn't it, to listen to. And the other thing as well, they say so much more, but I know Morgan and Veronica have been two of our sparkly story writers for our library, and they've both said they now know the starting point for story, if you remember the beginning of my presentation, and they know what to do, how to do it, and they realise not to be too timid, that they can be loud. It's okay to be loud. So just fabulous. And just all the families and all the parents have been overwhelmed, incredibly overwhelmed, and I constantly am, by the difference the Storytime show has made. But I really want to bring in my wonderful, esteemed colleagues, Donna and Megan now, because without them, there would be no story time show, and I would be making characters just here for the fun. So I'd love to share with my lovely colleagues and let them talk now. So I'm just going to set the ball rolling, but you guys just go for it. So Donna, I'm going to ask you first. Why did you feel you needed to be part of this show?
So hi, everyone. I had to find my hat. And you know what, Megan, we're going to have to get you a hat next. So we're going to work on that. So what happened was, Gwyn was doing this show, and you saw her show pictures of Oliver and Zachariah. Those were the first two showgoers in the beginning. And their moms, Rochelle and Leah, are just the best. And just watching that show, and Gwyn came and said, what do you think? And I'm thinking, this would be fabulous. We could do this, because we really wanted to find a time that we could create that intimate story time for our family to have fun together, to watch, to learn about characters, hear the stories, hear the music on there. And that was just the initial go, Gwyn, on why we wanted to do it. How about you, Megan?
So I met Donna in a drop-in call one day, and she was kind of hearing the news. There's a story time coming. It's going to be great. Everyone get involved. And I emailed her, and I missed the email and went to my junk box. I was on vacation for a week. I came back, and I was like, oh, no. I got a hold of Donna, and I was like, is it too late to sign up? And she was like, yes. And I was like, I've got to have this. I have to have this boat. And she's like, absolutely. The reason I was so attracted to it is we're in the middle of a pandemic. People can't leave their houses. Everyone's overwhelmed. I have two young kids. I get it. So having fun when you're super busy is hard. I saw this really excited lady with very sparkly objects that were just so appealing and fun and literacy and learning and then more fun. And you add songs to it that you cannot get out of your head. No matter how old you are, you sing the songs all day long. I had to have the show. I didn't have to beg very hard, which I'm grateful for. But yeah, it was, this show is just so attracting to me because it works. Everything about it works. It backs up from computers. I mean, of course, we have to use a computer to connect to each other, but you're not like on devices. You don't communicate with devices. You communicate with objects in your hand and physical movement and actions and motions. It's, I love this show.
Thank you, Megan. So Donna, what would be your advice to both parents and educators taking part in the Storytime show?
I think it goes back to what Karanika was saying, that when she first got on, she thought, oh, I don't think Delilah is really getting it, understanding it. I don't know if she's going, if this is something for Delilah. But the thing was, Karanika and Delilah stayed on. And as each week went on, Delilah really connected more and more. So like my biggest advice is to give it a try, because we had no idea. I mean, when we started this, and as Gwyn said, it's run through all the Deafblind projects. We're so lucky in the Midwest and the Southeast, we've all come together to create this. But we had no idea that the kids who most people would think would never connect to a screen, they were the kids that connected to the screen. They were the ones that were listening and hearing all the different voices that Gwyn was doing to illustrate who was talking, which character it was, what they were doing. And she was using all those skills to engage kids. So I would say, just keep trying and don't give up on the first time. Make it.
Thank you.
Yeah, to back up that, try and do it in small sessions. Sometimes kids are overwhelmed very quickly. And typical kid, I get overwhelmed quickly with things, right? So just as Gwyn was saying earlier, running, she didn't know that she could run. Well, she didn't get out and start running from the couch. You have to take small steps. So keep that in mind when you're working with any human at all, is small steps are sometimes the way you have to go, and persistency and try. And after a while, what we saw were most of the kids that we thought would never connect were the ones that connected the strongest, yes, who had the strongest desire to continue to show and need to be around with it. So give it a try.
I think as well, we as professionals, we assume and make decisions on behalf of children, and we go, oh, that won't work for them, so we won't bother trying, and we make the judgment, but we're not the ones, it's not for us, the show isn't for us, it's for the child. So it's very, we have to be very careful as adults that we don't make sweeping decisions on behalf of our child. And it might be, like you say, it might be the sixth show when the connection begins to happen. And yeah, they might not know the story words, but that, because they've learned to engage and attend and communicate and vocalize more, that then helps them in another session on something else. So it's developing the literacy access skills as well, I think, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Donna, can I ask you, what difference do you think that the Storytime show has made?
So I think this, for me, is it builds such confidence in our families and our any professionals really who are watching, for them to create their own story time, to take even the story times that you've done, Gwyn, and pull so much information out of there to build on other skills. It's not just a one-time thing. It's something that can be expanded over time. So I think that for me is one of the biggest things that I see. Megan?
I see that this has allowed families to connect mm-hmm. with the child, connect with having fun, connect with being more playful, and also intertwining that with education. Just like you're saying, to expand some more, it's kind of like it's a building block, right? So Gwyn's starting the foundation of something that typically people don't feel comfortable doing. I'm not a loud and, you know, Gwyn type person myself, and connecting with my children like that, I've actually opened up to do that more now. And I'm like, I can do this. Come on, let's go. It's a building block though. It's like a platform to continue to go on. And now the kids are reciprocating, right? Like, so now we're going back and forth. It's fantastic. Just guys, get on this. Do this show.
Well, Megan, I know you shared with me that Callie, your eldest daughter, goes around the house and gets everybody going, go, 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 all go, she go.
All the time. Yeah, we've got a lot of what we call Gwynisms in our house. She hasn't watched the show for 5 months, probably. But yeah, she does it all the time. She's got to go, 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 itty, go all the places.
Yeah. Yeah, that's brilliant. Thank you. I think you've both hit on the really important aspects of this. And actually, the bottom line is fun. It's fun. Fun. If we learn through fun, we learn quicker in a more enjoyable way, I think, don't we? It's just having fun. And fun is so important in our lives, and sometimes that can get overlooked. If we as parents, professionals have fun, the children have fun. Mm-hmm. And I guess this is a similar, perhaps a little bit similar, but just to round up, Donna, why do you think this story time show is so important? You know, what do you think has been the biggest outcome for your families from this?
So I wrote down some notes here so I don't forget, but it's just like what Megan was talking about. It's building confidence to have fun during story time, to think of other ways. You know, when we think of story time, a lot of times we think of books, sitting and reading. Well, this is giving families another way for the family to have fun and be together and watch story time. It's that enjoyment, like you and Megan talked about, that fun part of it, because it is so much fun. And then just building on community too. I mean, it even builds on community where parents are connecting with parents and parents are connecting with you, Gwyn, and sharing what's going on. And then parents, even Karanika, who was interviewed before, what she did is she connected with the school team and she went into the school and she did the whole story in the school that she wrote. So she wrote her own story and with her own props, and she gave the kids shakers, and she did a big production that was for the kids there. So even more, it just gave her the confidence to do that, to share. It just keeps going, and then everyone is loving it.
And just before you come in, Megan, just to say that before the story time show, Karanika had never written a story, and there she was going into the school presenting to the whole class, and the children asked Karanika to write a second story. Imagine the confidence for Karanika of that. Amazing. We love Karanika.
Yes.
Megan, please do share.
That's amazing. Also to add to this is what I'm seeing were the children were able to have some independent activities. Mm-hmm. They were able to decide what they wanted to do. Yes, we presented this is an option, here are the things, but now you have the toys, now you have the Marvin or the crafts, and now the kids are able to have interaction when they wish to. Like the Morgan was saying that her child was crying when the show was over. That's very sad, but fantastic. Mm-hmm. He loves something, and he's able to show that he's so sad that it's over. So these kids are able to judge their own opinion, right? Make their own decision about something. And oftentimes we're like, here's a plate of food, this is what you're eating. Kids don't have a ton of decisions. Mm-hmm. So in addition to all the wonderful things Donna just said, I would just want to add that on to a little more independence for the students that we're serving.
Yeah, and that's massive, isn't it? We talk in normal terms, but really it's absolutely huge. Is there anything else either of you want to add? Before I take the reins back?
I just think what Megan said, jump on the bandwagon, come join us at Storytime. It is so much fun. It's a blast. And if you want more information, I'm sure Gwen's going to let you know how to get that, but just join us. It's great.
Megan?
I agree. It's so much fun doing the show. What had been the highlight of the period of time I was doing the show. I would look forward to the show every week. And all I did was like, take it away, Gwyn. It's so much fun. It's fun to be around. It's fun to see families get a hold of you, showing their children what they're doing and how much they enjoy it. It is a lot at the beginning. So take it in and sit back and take in little steps. At the beginning, I was like, what is happening? Again, I'm a much quiet person. I'm a much quieter person. But I got in. And I got in. I went full in. I'm Marvin Show. 100%. Get in on the show. It's so much fun. You deserve fun too. Families, teachers, y'all deserve fun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we forget that as well. We do forget that we deserve to have fun. We're so busy going down the list, but we can have fun.
Yeah, it actually makes the list easier to do. It makes the list easier to complete whenever you have moments of time to have fun and blow off steam and be silly. So keep that in mind for your own mental health as well.
Yes. Okay, thank you so much, Donna and Megan. What can I say? You know, there's so many rich outcomes. I talk about this on my Facebook page all the time because I really need to get the message out. It's vital to get this message out. It's hugely important in my life, and I hope you see why. I'm so glad you came to find out today. So I'm going to wrap it up with one quote and ask for any questions. I'm just going to go back to my share screen and just this is actually from Megan. Megan wrote this, summed it up for me a little while ago. She said, I have a typically developing child who adores the show, but what makes it incredibly special to me is the inclusion and visibility of differently abled humans. They can be reached. They want to have fun and enjoy life just the same as the next person. Your show allows for that and proves you don't need expensive tech to do so. Now, thank you, Megan. That was in a conversation I held with Megan a good 6 months ago, just on Messenger, and she wrote that to me. And I thought, that just sums up the Storytime show. You know, the children with complex learning needs always have to fit into somebody else's frame, don't they? And this time, this allows everybody, them to take part inclusively and have fun, play, learn, engage, communicate in just the most beautiful, incredible way. So that's my presentation with my wonderful colleagues, Donna and Megan, and it's been a huge joy to do that. Does anybody have any questions? I'm happy to bring up, open the chat to ask anybody if you'd like to. I don't know how this works. If you want, if you can put your mics on to ask me.
If they raise their hand, if they want to ask a question instead of typing it, I can open their mic for them. If that's how you want to take the questions, I'm fine with either one.
Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Oh, there is a question about, will we have access to the video after this presentation?
I believe so. Is it 2 weeks, Alaya?
Yes, in a couple of weeks, they'll have access to the recording of the webinar, but I don't know if Karen is asking about the videos separately, the ones that you've been showing, or do you mean, Karen, the webinar? The webinar, got it. Okay, she clarified. Yes, okay. In a couple of weeks, you should be able to access the recording for this webinar on our APH Connect Center YouTube channel.
Lovely.
Mm-hmm. And let's see, do I have any hands up? I'm scrolling down to see.
Gwyn, this is Donna. I'm wondering, I know Rochelle is on here too. I wonder if Rochelle would say something.
Oh, Rochelle. Yeah. That would be wonderful, Rochelle. Are you still there, Rochelle? Would you just...
Actually, Donna, if you find her before I do, you Rochelle follows, is that it?
Yes, that's it.
Okay, let me let's see how.
Rochelle, would you come in and just tell us about your experience with Zachariah? Because Rochelle is here, the mum of Zachariah.
Rochelle? Yeah. I think you should be able to turn your mic on.
Oh yeah, there we go.
There we go.
Hello. Hello, I'm just in the middle of sorting things with Zachariah. But yeah, I've just put a comment, just basically thanking Gwyn, because we've kind of been on the journey from the start, and to see Gwyn grow along the way has just been amazing. Honestly, lockdown, we were stuck in a house, we were told not to leave, and Gwyn saved the day. We look forward to 4 o'clock every day. Zachariah absolutely loved it. Gwyn got to know Zachariah very quickly, and adapted her show to suit his needs as well as the other children, which I just thought was amazing. Zachariah reacts well to a deep voice. Gwyn didn't mention the character, but the, my mind's
crazy
going
crab,
to the...
Crazy Crab Craig.
Crazy Crab Craig was Zachariah's favourite. And Gwyn knew this, and the communication that I was allowed to have with Gwyn was amazing. She was very open about, pop me a message, keep me informed of how Zachariah is reacting, tell me how I can adapt it for him. Gwyn's just amazing, and we love her.
Thank you, Rochelle. But really, for Zachariah, you saw the difference in him, didn't you? With him raising his arms and shouting at me and getting involved, he wouldn't have responded like that, Rochelle, would he, if he hadn't been entertained by an engaged.
No, and I really got to know Zachariah a lot more through the show. There were things that I didn't know he could do, hadn't thought about him achieving. And through Gwyn and her show, I was able to see that, capture it, and develop on from that. With his vision, he is very much blind. And I was kind of like, how do I show Zachariah the world? How do I bring it to him? And I learned that through Gwyn. Being on the spot, I can't think of particular stuff, to be precise, but lots of little developments that happened from the show.
Yeah, no, that's lovely, Rochelle. Thank you so much. Thank you. We didn't mean to put you on the spot when you're multitasking there. Thank you so much, Rochelle. No, it's really lovely to hear from you. And Zachariah and Oliver were my wonderful buddies in the early days. And actually, if Rochelle hadn't sent me the video footage and Leah, Oliver's mum, hadn't sent me the video footage and shown me the photographs, I probably wouldn't have carried on. They inspired me. When I saw them responding, I thought, I'm onto something here, I need to keep going. So I wouldn't have kept going otherwise, I don't think. They spurred me on, really.
Zachariah is absolutely loving listening to you.
Is he? Hey, Zachariah! Oh, so lovely to see you, Zachariah. I've missed you.
There's another question here about, I'm sorry for interrupting. In West Virginia, there's a TBI. It wants to know, is there a way for the Storytime show to be seen in West Virginia? She's thinking that there are several students who would benefit from this greatly. And do you do it on your Facebook, don't you? It goes out on Facebook?
No, I don't do Storytime show on my Facebook.
No. Oh, okay. All right.
I used to.
That's COVID. I got it.
No, I work with the Deafblind projects with Donna and the projects across Southeast states and Midwest states, and the children register via their project.
And Gwyn, this is Donna. I put in the chat that she can just contact me. We'll work it if she's interested. Aww. So my email, and I know Megan put hers in there too. Just contact us and we'll see what we can do.
And I'd like to add one more thing to that. We are hoping to contract and get Gwyn on board to do this for the APH Connect Center in partnership with with Gwyn and with the Midwest Deafblind Project. So maybe you'll be able to, everybody will be able to access this, which is what I want. I want everybody to access this across the country and across the world. So so hopefully that we'll get that going soon. But yeah, in the meantime, getting a hold of Donna or Megan, they can help and see how they can help kiddos in West Virginia access this.
Can you reshare your email, Donna and Megan, because I can't see them. It needs to go into the everyone message. I think we've emailed ourselves rather than the whole group. So we just need to do it again.
Oh yeah, you're right. It was just set to host and panelists. So okay, if you guys can re-email that, re-chat it and set your two to everyone. That way everybody
can see. Yeah, hopefully you should have.
Or Gwyn did it, never mind. Okay, thank you.
We should be done.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
So I'm very excited to work with APH and the Connect Center on the Storytime show and have global reach feels incredible. And to work with the Deafblind Project to do that with you will be amazing, because there are so many children out there who would benefit from this show. And it's an incredible offer of APH to facilitate this and enable us to just reach thousands more children, really. It's global domination for Marvin, I think, ahead. It's so exciting.
I think about the kiddos who are in refugee camps or in other places where they don't really have access to an education that they deserve for a kiddo who has multiple disabilities, deaf blindness or visual impairments or blindness. But most of the time in those camps, somebody has a phone or, a smartphone, and they can access something like this on their phone, and those kids can get some benefit from what you're doing, Gwyn. Even if they're not in school, they may be in these situations where they're not getting services, but if they have access to a phone or an iPad or something in that camp, somebody can get those kids access to at least this, because this will improve their condition and their quality of life so much, even if it's just this 1 hour with you. And so I'm really looking forward to being able to do that and get people to reach that, for this to reach that far out, because I think the benefits are just incredible for these kiddos.
That would be like a living the dream on I don't know what. That's amazing. I would love to reach I would love to reach children in a refugee camp. Mm-hmm. That would be so wonderful.
Yes.
How do you reach them then, Alea? How do you do that? Do you have
very there was an NGO called Empowerment Through Integration. Uh-huh. And that was their purpose. Their purpose was to reach the kids in refugee camps who had blindness, visual impairments, deaf blindness. And so through working with them, through partnering with them, we are going to be trying to implement this, that project where the kids could, really training the parents and then the parents being able to train work with their kids in the refugee camp, kind of like the early intervention model where we train the parents to work with their children. But we have to provide them a way to get the training, and that would be through an iPad or a phone. And so that is something that the NGO is working out, and that we are going to be partnering with them. And actually one of the people who was working on that became part of the Biden administration in that realm, special education realm and access. So it's kind of neat that she kind of got promoted to that to that level. So we're hoping to expand on and really go out there and do that for those kids.
Yeah. No, that's brilliant. Some people are asking for the closing code because they've got to go back to work.
Oh, okay.
I'm just letting them...
Okay, so let me, I'm going to pause again. Okay, well, thank you so much, Gwyn. Gwyn, I will, I'll let you close it out.
Yeah, no, thank you. And thank you for just blowing my mind even more with the fact that the Storytime show could potentially reach children in a refugee camp. I mean, that for me is beyond what I ever imagined would ever happen. But those are the children whose life chances are so, so very reduced. So just to have a little bit of joy and fun and to have some colour and sparkle in their in their life would be an incredible experience for them and would offer some learning opportunities just to take part, just to dance, just to sing, just to enjoy, you know, that they will be learning in that situation.
In that so situation, think, exactly. So I'm so glad they reached out to us, and I know with one person leaving, going to the administration, obviously things are delayed and hopefully they'll get it back up and going. But once they do, we will be partnering with them for that.
Yeah,
and I will keep you in mind, because I just think this is one way to brighten their days for one, but also get them to get involved and engaged in ways that maybe they're not at that point.
Yeah, no, thank you. And thanks, everybody. I'm very appreciative of all the lovely feedback in the chat box. And it's just a wonderful, amazing, incredible honor. And I feel like I'm living my dream. Thank you.
Oh, yeah, this is great. I thank you so much for your time and for staying on with us. I know it's late over there. It's early over here. but we really appreciate it. And everybody, stay tuned for more good stuff coming from Gwyn through the Connect Center. And so we'll see you soon. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.